They've been going all around the city and doing incredible work. So in my tradition, I'm going to have my Pastor Jay, if you come up here and just open us up in a word of prayer, and then we're going to get started.
I'm going to ask everyone just stand if you can. We're grateful for this day to get information, to make suggestions, and thank Pastor Q, and have been working together to bring the community to get to hear voice. So let us pray. Father, we thank you now for this day.
Yes.
For this is the day that you have made. We shall rejoice and be glad. We thank you now, Father, we have come together as a community, as a people, from all areas of life to hear questions today and to make suggestions and recommendations. We pray that this be a meeting of fruitfulness, God. Not only help us to not just be hearers of what we hear today, but help us to activate it. That when we leave here, we will put it into action, implement it. So we pray today, God, that ideas come forth. Give us clarity of thought, articulate the speech that will be made here today, God. And bless it now. Bless it. We pray now even the what's happening in our country right now, God. We pray for peace in our country. We pray for unity. We pray for love. We pray for a spirit of love and unity in this country. So bind us together. And I pray that there will be a microcosm of that. Bless us now. Bless the leaders and the sponsors that have come together to have this conversation and discussion today is my prayer. In Jesus' name, amen.
Amen.
Amen. Let's just give the Lord a hand clap. Amen.
Amen. Amen. And so again, for those that don't know, many of you already know, my name is Reverend Q English. My husband, Pastor Tim, and I, we pastor the Bronx Christian Fellowship Church right there on Gun Hill between Paulding and Laconia. And I'm doing this in partnership with my brother, Pastor Jay Gooding, and also, where's Keith Ramsey? Keith Ramsey has disappeared, but he was, so here he is. Keith Ramsey is so gracious to allow us to hold this forum in his community, specifically here in his gymnasium. As many of us know, that this was the area where there were many youngsters swept up on the federal end. But here we're very intentional about hearing from you. This is a forum about you contributing your voice to what's been happening around the city with the joint remedial process team led by Judge Berlin and some of his staff that he will introduce when I introduce him. So, you know, they've been going around. I've had the opportunity of introducing them to our youngsters around the five boroughs through our Arches program, which is a program for those that are on probation. And they were able to go to a lot of the sites in the five boroughs and actually ask our young people some pointed ideas and recommendations regarding stop and frisk and trespassing practices. So to that end, I'm grateful to that we were able to host one in the South Bronx, which went extraordinarily well. Again, we have some youth that are on their way now that will be taking part of the conversation. And so we're just looking forward to a very, very enriching time. So again, this is about you. We're not going to spend a lot of time talking. They're going to share what they've been doing and what we hope to gain at the end of this. But we want to hear from you. It's your ideas. It's your recommendations so that we can have a safer community for all. At this time, I want to introduce Judge Berlin. If we can put our hands together for him, who is overseeing this project. And I know it's going to have great outcomes. Thank you.
Thank you very, very much, Reverend, for inviting us here today and putting this together. Very briefly, I'm a retired New York State Appellate Division judge. I work for a firm called Judicial Arbitration Mediation Services, called JAMS. I was appointed by the federal court in Manhattan, the Southern District of New York, 2 years ago now, to conduct what is known as the New York City Joint Remedial Process in conjunction with the federal monitor of the New York City Police Department, who's a lawyer by the name of Peter Zimrock. So there's a federal monitorship that's been imposed on the police department. Actually, the judge ruled in 2013. The mayor withdrew all the appeals. And effectively, the monitor has been working at the police department to try and implement reforms for 2 years. What we're going to do today is talk a little bit about the reforms that the monitor has worked with the police department to make happen, implement, and my process, which is different. The reason I'm here today is because my mandate is to go across New York City to communities that were mainly affected by unconstitutional stop and frisk and trespass enforcement by the police department for more than a decade or so, and get community input around potential additional reforms. Again, going around the city, have about 25 forums, we did around 64 focus groups, we have a bunch of other leadership meetings, as we call them, but the object is I get input from folks. I have several facilitators here who are in breakout sessions, who will be listening, taking down your insights and your suggestions. We take all that stuff and then I write a report to the federal court at this point early next year to then recommend, potentially recommend to the court additional reforms of the police department. What I'd like to do right now is we have a video that we'd like to play for you, and then I'll come back and give you a little bit more insight, then we'll move on with the program. So, does anyone know how to start this thing up here? Okay, then I won't.
Yeah, hit play. Can is that little speaker?
Thank you.
Sorry that this didn't work so well, so I don't think you really got to hear what was there. But I'll spend a little bit more time with you than describing again why we're here. So, this sheet that I gave out to you, say to you that, I'll just walk you through it, right? So where it says timeline, you see that beginning with the Amazon the Owl shooting back in 1999, a lawsuit was brought called Daniels versus New York City, and it ends right here where we are at the very end saying you are here. So the three cases at the bottom, the Floyd case, the Davis case, and the Legone case, were lawsuits that were brought against the police department for unconstitutional stop and frisk policies. So let me say this just to give you a framework from which to understand. The police anywhere in the United States have a right, they probably have an obligation to stop someone, question them, and frisk them. If, and only if, they have reasonable suspicion to believe that a person has committed a crime, is about to commit a crime, or has committed a crime. Again, the police can stop a person, meaning they, in that person's head they feel like they're not free to leave, question the person, but only if they have reasonable suspicion to believe the person has committed, is about to commit, or is committing a crime. Once they've stopped the person, if they also have reasonable suspicion to believe the person is armed and dangerous, they can frisk the person, which means lightly touching their outer clothing, patting them, and if they feel what appears to be a weapon, actually search the person. Now, the reason I'm here is that that's not going to happen a lot throughout the city of New York for a long, long, long time. The police were stopping people, frisking, if not outright, just searching them without anything remotely appearing to be reasonable suspicion. And so these lawsuits were brought, the Floyd case about street stops, the Davis case actually about public housing. I'm going to talk to you a little bit about that, because in the context of public housing, it's actually a variety of stop questions and frisks, but the police took to stopping people, asking them, what are you doing here? Where do you live? You got ID? You don't have ID? What do you got on you? Let me see your pockets. Where's your ID? Where do you live? Boom, there's no one here arresting you for trespass. And they would approach people in this way without any suspicion or any basis at all, other than perhaps they're standing outside this building or they're standing in the hallway. Now, question for you. How many stop and frisks were conducted by the New York City Police Department in calendar year 2011, 5 years ago? And mind you, the police have to record all these stops. So this is recorded stops. Anybody know? Take a guess, how many there were in 2011, 5 years ago, in New York City, all of New York City?
A lot.
20,000? Sure. 20? 200? 685,000. Almost 700,000 stops.
Bloomberg.
That's right. In a city of 7 million people. Okay? Now you understand why I'm here. So, now, since you may have brought up Mayor Bloomberg and Commissioner Kelly, even the next year, in 2012, the stops started to drop, really because of public pressure and protests. They were about 300,000 then. Anybody want to tell me how many stops there were in New York City in 2015 that were recorded? Again, I'm telling you, the police actually would make a record. Anybody? 25,000. This past year, they've recorded around 10 to 12,000 so far. You've gone from a height of almost 700,000 stops in 2011 to about 25,000 in 2015, and you half of that is at this year. These are documented stops. So it could be the case that there's maybe more happening now that aren't being documented. And anecdotally, I kind of hear that wherever I go around the city. But Even given, you know, that possibility, it's clear that the number has dropped, you know, significantly. Like I said, well, let me put it another way. 95% of the people who were stopped and questioned in this manner for nearly a decade or more were either Latino or African American. Okay? 95% of persons of color. Only 5% of the time on average was anyone actually arrested as a consequence of the search or the stop. The percentage of guns recovered actually was like a 1% out of all that. And 6% of the time people were issued summonses. So very clearly you have a very massive policy of stopping people less than the law allows, and, you know, searching them and infringing their constitutional rights. So the federal court imposes a federal monitor. So you'll see on the back of this sheet something called reforms. So in that regard, there's six major areas of reforms. Revisions to the policy of stop and frisk and racial profiling and interior patrols in NYCHA buildings. There's a camera, a Pilot One camera project, which has actually been expanded. It's a very good likelihood that within a couple of years, all police officers in New York City will be wearing body-worn cameras. Police must have better supervision. They have to sign off on the documentation. So traditionally, it was the way a police reported the stop. What I mean by that is if you're walking outside, and actually here for that matter, and they stop you, they have to, and they don't arrest you, and even if they do, but certainly if they don't, they have to fill out a form. That's how we know there were 685,000. They're called a stop form. But that form was a checklist. The checklist would say things like high crime neighborhood, furtive gestures, suspicious approach. Pretty, you know, general conclusory statements. Now they have to spell out what it is. Cops are being evaluated differently. One of the reasons that, the biggest reason that you got to all these numbers was that the way cops were promoted was based on activity. Okay? And that's not longer the case. And finally, they're being trained differently on implicit bias and procedural justice. Now, in housing, the reforms are, just so you'll know, that a little, you know, more intense, right? So now, police officers can't approach and question someone for simply being in public housing. They just simply can't come up to you just because you're here. They have to speak with people in a polite, non-accusatory manner, unless they have some articulable suspicion of criminal activity. You can't be arresting people in restricted areas of public housing unless they have sufficient notice from conspicuously posted signs. And the officers must make reasonable efforts to verify a person's authority to be in the building before they make an arrest for trespass. There's also revisions to the house rules for NYCHA that have come into effect. The so-called lingering rule is now have a much more specific definition. The cops must fill out trespass crime fact sheet reports, detailing ways, in fact, they've arrested someone for trespass. So these are all fairly significant reforms that are being implemented as we speak. And again, the reason I'm here is to hear from you as to any thoughts you may have around additional reforms to the department. So with that, I'll turn over the mic to, well, Reverend Gibb. Yep. She's back up. And we're going to break out soon into small groups that are going to have a discussion, facilitated discussion, and then we'll convene back together. I would have fetched you first, but she doesn't like to do that, so don't blame me.
Thank you, Judge. And can we introduce your team as well?
So I have here Reynaldo Rivera, who's my senior advisor, before working with me, worked with the United States Department of Justice for a very long time, implementing these types of processes. There's Janine Barrett. Janine's my project manager. Valerie Paul, assistant project manager. And Jennifer's the project assistant, Jennifer Dionisio. You also have from the monitors team, Jim McKay, who's the former director of training in the police department. He's retired chief of the police department. He's actually from the monitors team here as well.
Thank you. Great, great. Give him a hand. So now it's your time to have your voice, and the way we're going to do this is, how many monitors do we have today? So three groups, right? Okay, so we're going to break up into three groups. There's going to be a monitor assigned to each group. They're going to ask specific questions, and this is where you're going to just pour your heart out and letting them know what you feel, what your recommendations are, what you've observed, whether directly or indirectly. This is your opportunity. And at the end of this conversation, Judge is going to actually prepare your report. That's going to go to federal for their consideration and implementation. So, based on the number of people we have, we're going to have another youth group come. So we're just sort of combining them when they come in your group. So we're going to start out with groups of seven. So this seven right here, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, you want 6, 7. If y'all can just grab your chair, we're going to create a circle right here. And if I can have